Okay, so we're going to be talking about the addition property of equality. So this is one of the properties involved when it comes to solving equations. Now, as you probably know, solving equations are a huge part of algebra. Almost everything that you do in math classes has to do with solving some type of equation. So understanding the following properties that I'm going to go over are extremely important. So the first one we're going to talk about is the addition property of equality. And this is what the book definition says right here. So it says that if A equals B, right, then A plus C is equal to B plus C. Now, what that actually means, so I'm going to plug in some numbers here so maybe it could be a little bit more clear on what this is saying here. So I'm going to start off with this top part here, if A equals B. All right, so A equals B, which means they're the same thing. So I'm just going to say 10 equals 10. All right, 10 equals 10, that's true. All right, so if we notice here, the next part of the property says, well, then if I add C to both sides, right? Notice I'm adding the C over here on the left. I'm also adding it on the right-hand side. So notice I'm adding the same thing, right? So this is pretty much saying that I can add the same thing to both sides and it's still gonna be true. So that could look like this. So if I have 10 equals 10, so let's say I decide to add 2 to both sides. And as long as I'm adding it to both sides, I still have a true equation. Because on the left-hand side, I had a 10, I'm adding a 2. All right, so 10 plus 2 is a 12. On the right-hand side, I had a 10, I'm adding a 2 as well. So 10 plus 2 is 12. And 12 does equal 12. That is a true equation. So essentially what this property is actually telling us is that as long as we're adding the same thing to both sides, we're good. The same thing works for the subtraction property of equality, the multiplication property of equality, and the division property of equality. So I'm just going to change this slightly here. All right. So if we have the same property essentially, if A equals B, then A minus C is equal to B minus C. All this is saying, so once again, I'm going to start with 10 equals 10. All this is saying is that I can subtract the same thing from both sides, and I'm still going to get a true equation, right? So I can subtract 5 from one side, and as long as I'm subtracting the same thing from the other side, this is still a true equation, because 10 minus 5 is a 5 over here, and then I'm also going to get a 5 over here. And 5 does equals 5, so we're good there. So the same thing works for the multiplication and for the division as well. So I can multiply the same thing on both sides, right? If A equals B, then A times C is the same thing as B times C. So once again, if 10 equals 10, well, hey, I can do times 3 over here. And as long as I'm going to do times 3 over here, it's the same thing because 30 equals 30. And then if I decided, just starting from here, if I decided to divide, as long as I'm dividing by the same thing on both sides, then we're good. So I can divide by a 2, and as long as I'm dividing by a 2 over here, I'm still going to get a true equation. 30 divided by 2 is 15, and on the right-hand side as well. All right, so I say all of this. So these are the four main properties when it comes to solving equations, and they're going to help you out in almost everything that you do with equations. So when I teach solving equations, there's always two main points that I talk about. Okay, so these are the two main things that I was mentioning here. So the first thing is what we kind of just talked about. What you do to one side, you must do to the other side. So if I'm going to subtract on one side, I need to subtract the exact same thing on the other side. And the same thing goes with addition, multiplication, and division. The other thing over here, so this second point over here deals with rearranging and actually going through the steps of solving equations. And I'm going to elaborate on that in just a little bit here. And this says to do the opposite. So to start us off, I have this one-step equation down over here at the bottom. So when we're looking at equations, right, I always say always focus your attention on where the variable is, right, your letter, right? So you're looking at your alphabet here. And when we solve an equation, we're always solving for x or whatever that variable happens to be. And the whole point is to get x all by itself, right? We want this to read x equals some number, and that would be a solved equation. Well, when I'm looking at equations, what I really think of it when I look at these equations here is, to me, it's just a big puzzle. It's a big rearranging game. I need to move things around in the equation until I get x all by itself. So when I'm looking at this equation, I have this x sitting over here. And in order to get x all by itself, well, for this equation, there's only one thing that I would need to get rid of, and it's this 5 here. And that's where this do the opposite comes in. So when you're rearranging, when you're trying to get x by itself, you want to do the opposite calculation of what you have. So I have this 5 I need to get rid of. Now, I need to pay attention to what sign is in front of that 5. And here I have a plus sign. So then I need to think, well, okay, what's the opposite of a plus sign? Right? Opposite of a plus sign is a minus, just like opposite of a minus is a plus. If I had multiplication, then the opposite would be division and vice versa. So here I have a plus 5. So I need to get rid of that 5 in order for x to be by itself. So when I get rid of things, when I rearrange, I do the opposite. So if I want to get rid of a plus 5, I'm going to do the opposite and I'm going to minus a 5. But I always need to keep this first point in mind, because this says what I do to one side, you must do to the other side. So if I'm going to minus 5 over here, I have to minus 5 on that right hand side as well. After this, it's just a matter of simplifying. So on the left hand side, I had a 5. I'm minusing a 5, so that's going to go away, because 5 minus 5 is 0, so that's totally gone. I'm going to drop down the x, and then I'm going to simplify the right hand side. On the right hand side, I had a 12. I'm subtracting 5 from it, so 12 minus 5 is a 7. And here I go, x is already by itself. That was a one-step problem. I am done. The one thing that you do want to keep in mind when it does come to equations, pretty much every single equation that you solve, you are able to check your work when it does come to the equations. If I wanted to figure out, you know, maybe I'm taking a big test and I really want to make sure that my answer is correct, the way that you would do that is you're going to take your answer here and you're going to plug it back into your equation for your variable. If x is 7, I should be able to plug in 7 for x right here. Right, and keep the rest of the equation and check to make sure it is correct. So there I had an x plus 5. If x is 7, that means I now have a 7 plus 5, and 7 plus 5 is 12. So here I do have a true equation, so that means that this is correct. So let's do another one. Okay, so here we have a couple of other examples, starting with the one on the left-hand side here. So here I have an x minus a 3 is equal to a negative 8. So again, always focus on where your variable is. So I have my x sitting over here on the left-hand side, and I need to look around to see what else is going on. And the only other thing that I see going on over here is that I have a minus a 3, so then I need to do the opposite of what I have. So since I have minus 3, I want to do the opposite and add 3. So I'm going to add 3 on that left-hand side, remembering that I have to do it to the other side as well. So I'm going to add 3 to the right-hand side. On the left-hand side, negative 3 plus 3 is going to cancel out, leaving me with x. And on the right-hand side, we had a negative 8. We're going to add a 3. So you need to remember your integer rules. All right, so here I have a negative 8 plus 3. The integer rules for different signs says to subtract the numbers and take the sign of the bigger one. So 8 minus 3 is a 5, and the bigger number is the 8. It's negative, so I'm going to take that sign. Or remember, I always think about this in terms of money. If I have negative $8 right here, so if you had negative $8 in your bank account and you added $3 to it, you're still negative, but you're only negative 5. All right, so that's another way to look at it there. So moving on to the equation on the right-hand side, so here I have 2x is equal to negative 48. So do keep in mind when you're looking at this 2x right here, all right, so we need to draw our attention to the variable. We have this 2 in front. You do need to understand when it comes to terms like this, it's understood that there's a multiplication symbol in between that 2 and the x. That's very important to understand, because then when we're trying to solve it here, we need to think about the calculation that's opposite that. So I have to understand that that is multiplication so that I can go and do the opposite. And the opposite of multiplication is division. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to divide by 2 on both sides so that I can get rid of that. All right, then we're going to simplify here. On the left-hand side, we have 2 divided by 2. So 2 divided by 2 does cancel. Do keep in mind, 2 divided by 2, what does that actually equal? Well, 2 divided by 2 equals a 1, right? So that would leave us with a 1x. But remember, 1 times x is just the same thing as an x. It's pointless to kind of write the 1 in front. It's just kind of additional information that we don't need. It's understood to be there. So we don't need to write that 1. So we can go ahead and just cancel out the 2s. On the right-hand side, we had a negative 48. We're going to be dividing it by 2. I would recommend take care of your signs first. You have a negative divided by a positive, and when it comes to division, different signs is always going to be negative. So I would go ahead and put my negative over here so I don't forget about it. Otherwise, 48 divided by 2 is a 24. So here I have x is equal to negative 24. Okay, so let's work the next few examples here, starting with the one on the left-hand side. So over here I have 9 is equal to x over 5. So again, always draw your attention to where your variable is. So for this particular equation, it's on the right-hand side, and it's in the numerator over here of this fraction. Also, do keep in mind when you're dealing with a fraction, right? This is a fraction, but always do remember that that fraction bar right there also means to divide. It is a division problem. So that when we're thinking about our solving equation steps and stuff like that, remember that we're trying to do the opposite of what we have. So here we have this x, and it's being divided by that 5. So the opposite of division would be what? All right, so the opposite of division is multiplication. So in order to get this x by itself, what I would have to do is I would have to multiply by that 5. So that's what I'm going to do here. I'm going to multiply by 5, making sure that I do that to both sides. Now when we do simplify over here, so on the right-hand side, I'm multiplying by 5. So if you're not as practiced with dealing with fractions here, I would go ahead and recommend to do this. So go ahead and put that 5 over a 1. Do keep in mind, in front of this x, it is understood to be a 1 as well. And when it comes to simplifying fractions, remember, if we have the same thing in the numerator as we have in the denominator, then we can cancel them out. Well, I have a 1 here that can cancel with that 1. I also have this 5 that can cancel with that 5. So actually, all of those do cancel out, leaving me with this x right over here. All right, so when I multiply by the 5, it ends up canceling out because that's simply just a 5 over a 5. So it does cancel. On the left-hand side, I had a 9. I multiplied it by a 5. So 9 times 5 is 45. So here I have that x is equal to 45. All right, so remember, if you want to go back and you want to check your work, do go back to your original problem here and plug in your answer to see if it's correct. So here, I would be plugging in a 45 where x is, and 45 divided by 5 is a 9. So we're all good there. Now over here on the right-hand side, we have 1/4 x is equal to 9. So first off, do understand that in between the 1/4 and the x, that is multiplication there, right? So there's a couple different ways that you can look at this problem. All right, that is a multiplication symbol, so we could continue to go and divide both sides by 1/4. On the left-hand side, 1/4 would cancel with 1/4, and over here on the right-hand side, we would just have to deal with this complex fraction, which isn't a big deal. It's very much doable. A lot of other people prefer to use this one property, and I have it written right up here. So at the top of the board over here, it says, when you have a fraction as a coefficient, take the reciprocal and multiply both sides of the equation by it. So first off, when you have a fraction as a coefficient, remember the coefficient is the number in front of the variable. So when you're dealing with a fraction here in front, take the reciprocal of it. So if you don't remember what that means, taking the reciprocal of a fraction just means to flip it around. So the reciprocal of 1/4 would be 4/1. The reciprocal of 2/3 would be 3/2. Right? So all you would have to do is flip it. So this says to flip the fraction and multiply both sides of the equation by it. So using this property here, if you can remember it, it saves you one step when it comes to solving your equations here. Right? So that's the property that I use when I teach. So I am going to use that property here. So if I want to solve for this x, instead of dividing each side by 1/4, I'm going to multiply by the reciprocal on both sides. So again, the reciprocal of 1/4 would be 4/1. So I'm going to multiply both sides of this equation by 4/1. On the left-hand side, notice these are going to cancel out here, leaving me with x. And on the right-hand side, we need to multiply. Go ahead and put that whole number over a 1, just so you can kind of keep it straight where my numerators are, where my denominators are. Because remember, when it comes to multiplying fractions, it's numerator times numerator, denominator times denominator, right? You go straight across. So here would be 9 times 4, which is 36, over 1 times 1, which is a 1. But again, keep in mind, 36 divided by 1 is just the 36. We don't need to write the over the 1. So here we would just have 36 as our answer.